Good afternoon. My name is Paul Bogards. On behalf of Gita and Aditya Mehta and all my colleagues at Knopf and Penguin Random House, welcome. I would like to take this moment to personally thank all the speakers for joining us this afternoon. Some of them traveled great distances to be here. The same can be said of many booksellers, agents, and publishing colleagues. The tether for them, indeed for all of us, is summer.
Convinced. You had to have optimism and confidence to be a good publisher, he would say.
No, not every book was a masterpiece or a success, but I would happily settle for his batting average. One Wednesday night at dinner at a French restaurant on East 50th Street, smoke in the air, whiskey flowing, Sonny asked me to come to Knopf. He said there were three conditions to his offer. One, I had to bring to Knopf the finest books and authors I could find. Two, I would only bring those books to market when they were as strong as they could be editorially. And three, we had to have good times. The first 6 months at Random House have been awful, he said, and they had been. We did have fun, lots of it, in our strange way. Sonny could be glum, I mean really glum, and I loved making him laugh. Once we had to go to the emergency room because he had stumbled and fallen. He had been lying flat on a litter for 5 hours in an emergency room without anyone paying attention. I said, Sonny, I know how we can get some attention. I'm going to go out and buy a pack of cigarettes. And then we will both light up and somebody will be here in 15 seconds. He smiled and attention was relieved for a bit. 2 years ago, Sonny called me on a Sunday night and, in his usual way, he said if I had absolutely nothing better to do, would I like to stop by his place and have a drink? I said that I was in the middle of designing my Joseph Goebbels themed Christmas cards, but I would be finished shortly and would stop by. When Sonny actually called me rather than emailed, I knew he had an agenda. When I got to his apartment, he asked me if I would be honest and tell him if the staff was growing tired of him and wanted him to bugger off. I gave him my assessment, which pleased him. He told me he was seeking his successor. I asked how wide his window was. He said, until I find the right person. I asked what he would do once he stepped down. He hadn't given it much thought, he said. Now that you've lost some weight, I suggested, I think you could have a great second career as a jockey. A year after that, he emailed me on a Sunday. Nothing urgent, he said, but why don't you stop by? Those were the invitations I lived for. I told him I would put aside my bidding, cancel my ballet class, and see him at 6. When I got there, as always, every seat was covered with pages of a manuscript. Given his propensity for cigarettes, I reminded him that there was a fire hazard. He asked me what I thought about the Hollywood figure we had met with 2 days before who wanted to write a memoir. I said, I think he's the kind of person who goes home at night and rips the wings off dead flies. Sonny got a kick out of that, and he asked me to call the fellow's agent the next day and say he wouldn't be offering. Later, Sonny got out of his chair and he walked around his library, pulling down books from the shelves. He ran his fingers over them. Beautiful book, he said once or twice. He thumbed through some of the hardcovers, feeling the paper between his fingers. He admired the jackets. The look of our books, their feel, were so important to him. They are a fitting legacy. Most of you probably know that Sonny's health had been in decline for a while. He walked with a cane, which I actually thought made him look more dapper. But I know how frustrating that was for him. He missed his long walks in the park, and stairs were a challenge. But his health did not diminish his capacity for work. Sonny was there every day. Indeed, he was one of the first ones at his desk. And on Fridays, he was often the only person at his desk. That was the way it had to be. Sonny lived a life of total commitment to publishing. It was the only life he ever wanted. Sonny's last day in the office was on a Thursday in December, the day of our holiday party. He walked to the podium without his cane and made his annual comments. There were, as always, a few laughs. Then he said, the true test of a company is not when business is good, but instead when business is not great. He then added, it seems we're being tested now. He said how strong a team we were, thanked us for the year's work, and told us the future was bright. Sonny was a master of tone. He always found a way to reassure everyone in the room. That's one of the reasons he commanded so much loyalty. He gave out bottles of champagne to those celebrating his service anniversary, kissed or hugged every recipient, and ambled back to his office. That was the last time anyone would see him. Alicia was, we would be in very good hands, he assured me. I'm going to stick around for a while, he said, help her adjust to the place. And pro forma, he said, are you okay with this? I said, no. I was hoping for Ivanka Trump. I have a photo of Sonny taken, I believe, in 1992 in Mexico. Sonny's jeans are pressed. He's wearing a beautiful new black shoes. His bracelet dangles stylishly around his thin wrist. The omnipresent cigarette held smoothly in his fingers. He is elegant. He was elegant in his Savile Row suits and Nehru jackets, too. But to me, he was at his most elegant near the end, as he walked through our halls, one carefully managed step at a time, leaving his cane behind. Elegant as he insisted on rising from his desk when visited by a foreign publisher, or to serve you a drink in his flat. Keita told me he was even elegant in how he looked as he left this earth. Was there ever a more elegant man? When Sonny died, Keita wrote to me, his life proved the value of a selfless constancy and a silent pursuit of excellence. Our guy was indeed a sensei. He was indeed a match. She also wrote to me, pain is bad, grieving is worse. Years ago, a colleague of mine named John Leonard wrote something in the New York Times that I've never forgotten. I'm at an age, he said, when I can't afford to lose another friend. I now I understand the meaning of that now. Sonny's death gives new meaning to the words black hole. But at the same time, Sonny was in your life. Inevitably, some of it rubbed off on you. The Ganges will receive his ashes next month, but make no mistake. When beauty dies, it leaves an indelible trace. Thank you.
Sonny was unlike any person I've ever met. were their silences, of course. They weren't strategic or tactical, they were just sunny. His apparent passivity was born of reserve, but it was also a self-imposed discipline that prevented him from speaking or acting without thought. When he interrupted his silences to speak, he was always lucid and part courtly, part coarse, part Henry James, part Norman Mailer. He would deliver barely audible verbal obligatos on the subject of friends, or books, or music, or politics, or performances, which would suddenly rise in pitch and volume and spiral either into damning indignation, as if it's fucking insane, or into unrestrained joy, as in she was really kind of wonderful, which Sonny was, of course, kind of wonderful. He had perfect manners. I don't mean the sort of common courtesies, which of course he performed with enormous religious conviction. I mean an ability to empathize with other people, real or imagined, which I suppose is what made him such a marvelous reader and brilliant publisher of fiction. He had what Simone Weil called a gift of compassion. I know slightly more than nothing, but a lot less than everything about New York publishing. But I do know that Sonny navigated its waters with unostentatious brilliance. I could never imagine him retiring, and nor, of course, could he. So, I guess that his way of retiring was best, even if to the very end it required huge stoicism and stubborn gallantry. He was like King Lear. The wonder was that he endured so long. He but usurped his life. Sonny changed the landscape of New York for me, and without him, New York will never be the same. Gita phoned me in the evening shortly after his death. I was standing appropriately in entirely accidental homage outside one of Sonny's favorite restaurants. Gita and I had a stammering conversation at the end of which she said, "You know, he was our guy." And if you were his wife, or his son, or his friend, or a writer, or a reader. She was right. He was our guy. Even those books he took risks with, that critics growled over.
hesitant when someone misspelled his name and sent a manuscript to this new publisher I could not. The envelope was addressed to Sonny Meadows. Sonny was spelled S-U-N-N-Y. Not a very accurate version of his personality. Shamelessly, I stole that name and used it in a book where Sonny Meadows became a melancholy pianist on a ship. Here the goal of the letters prod you out of your silences, making you say more, or he showed you how to say less, finding what was buried in the text that got in the way or was sending forth signals. One issue could be raised in reading the manuscript of The English Patient was the presence of Kip's brother. There were three or four things I found interesting about the brother. He was politically more radical and less modest than Kip. But Sonny held up those four or five pages and gave the strangest reason for why they should not be there. And I still think it's strange. You know, there's only one reason, he insisted, long pause, why you would have so much of him. What is that? If he's the central character in your next book. Well, of course not, I'm going to just finish this one. Then Robin. There will be other subliminal influences, solid gifts, like any great editor who was a secret sharer. I seldom talk about what a book is about when working on it, but one day when I was with him, halfway through writing The Cat's Table, I let slip it was about a boy's journey by ship from Sri Lanka to England. It was a journey I had in fact made as an 11-year-old boy in the 1950s. Sonny said nothing. We were in his apartment. He just wandered off. But half an hour later, he came back and silently handed me a picture of him as a boy, wearing a tie, I still remember. Also on a ship going to England, same year. We did not speak about any further similarities or episodes in our mutual sea journeys, and nothing more was said about the novel I was writing. But I think, in retrospect now, there was all a sense of community among the boys in my book after that. The narrator was less alone. None of the other boys were modeled on Sonny, but there was now more of a gang. It felt as if they had a purpose. My book was no longer about just one individual's solitary journey to England anymore. Living one soul for another can be terrifying. It still is. And it can be permanent, unless you are lucky. This is true not just for those from faraway countries, but for those leaving their original childhoods in America. The poet Dennis Johnson wrote, "I can see the lights of the city I came from, can remember how a boy sets out like someone thrown from the furnace of a star." For later generations, that big boy in England, North America, Sonny will be there. And for years he provided a sense of community as well as a rival to writers from elsewhere. And soon there will be all these novels, international as hell, we discovered when we were beginning to write. Thanks to you, Sonny. Thank you for the phantom limb of Kip's brother that still exists silently and unloosed in that book. Thank you for the friendship you and Keith gave us. Thank you for the photograph of the boy wearing a tie, leaving home, looking ahead. I'll end the poem I wrote some years ago about friendship between artists. Because I lost that cane, when you lose that ballet, it's called the Great Tree. Zulay died like a dragon breaking down. This line shows and ribboned in cursive script by his friend the poet Yang Weijin, whose father built a library surrounded by hundreds of plum trees. It was Zufule, almost unknown, who made the best plum flower painting of any period. One branch lifted into the wind, and his friend's vertical line of character, their tones of ink, wet to opaque, dark to pale. Each sweep and gesture trained in the high plum surrounded library where young Richard studied as a boy, the movable staircase was pulled away to ensure his solitary concentration. His great work, untrammeled, eccentric, unorthodox, no taint of the superficial, no flamboyant movement, music at times the lifted tales of archaic script, sharing with Soufflet his leaps and darknesses. So I have always held him in my heart. The 14th century court calligrapher mourns the death of his friend. Language attacks the people from the air. There's only a path of blossoms, no flamboyant movement. The night of Smokey Aiken, 1361. The night without a staircase.
He motioned for us to come in and sit down. "I'm just having my lunch," he said. I looked at his desk. There were books and papers, but no food. He registered my confusion and motioned toward his scotch. As we proceeded to talk, I started to feel myself loosen up, probably for the first time in months. Sunny had that.
T.S. Eliot wrote, if you came this way, starting from anywhere, at any time and in any season, it would always be the same. You would have to put off sense and notion. You are not here to instruct yourself or to inform curiosity or to carry a report. You are here to kneel where prayer has been proven valid. We are assembled in a vast cathedral of books. The great Sunny Mehta, the great publisher of the world, English language, worshipped the printed word on paper, and we are here to celebrate this brilliant, reckless, dedicated man's temporal journey, and to pray and wish him onward to his soul's repose. And Sexton wrote, my friend, I was born doing reference work in sin, and born confessing it. This is what poems are, with mercy for the greedy. They are the tongue's wrangle, the world's pottage, the rat's star. We hitched our star to Sunny Mehta. We gave him our wrangle, our pottage. We gave him our printed words on paper, our confessions, often indelicate, incautious, indecorous. And he sifted our words, and he measured our words, and by his luminous touch, he made our words, our printed words on paper, immeasurably better. Sunny Mehta, 1920, 1942 to 2019. We have Eliot and we have Sexton, and Shakespeare says it best for me. I owe this dead man more tears than you shall see me pay. 20-odd years ago, Sonny and I indulged a late-night bullshit session at his swank pad at 62nd and Park. We talked books, books, and books. We talked Beethoven, Bruckner, and Brahms, and the incautious, indelicate, and indecorous issue of who's doing over time, our discussion turned to death, chiefly which one of us would go first. Sonny said to me, if you go first, what would you like me to read at your wake? And I said, I want you to read In Memory of W.B. Yeats by W.H. Auden. Sonny considered this and asked, yes, yes, I could read that, but what would you read in my wake? I considered the question. I pondered it for a moment. And I said, I don't know, boss, but I'll think of something. Sonny has gone first. I have thought of something. Hence, A.E. Housman. The day you won your town the race, we cheered you through the marketplace. Man and boy stood shoulder high, and home we brought you passing by. Today the road Tony Mazza, 1942 to 2019. Hausman to the Book of Revelation. And I looked up, and a door opened in heaven, and a voice that I had heard before spoke like a trumpet blast. The voice said, "Come up here, and I will tell you what must happen next."
We want Jandun. We want thy holy fool. Down through the weeks of ages, in the moss-born dark dank pool. Raybon down through industrial revolution. Atomic and nuclear age. Raybon down through time and space. Down through the corridors. Raybon. Words on printed page. Raybon, you left us infinity, as well as press pages torn to fade. Drive on with wild abandon. Rave, my brother, rave. Raybon, walk with me. Nose down in wet grass. Raybon and fill the senses on nature's bright and shady path. Raybon, Omar Khayyam. Raybon, Cahill the Brand. Oh, what sweet wine we drink in the celebrations that will be held. We will partake the holy wine and break the holy bread. Come on, Raybon. Raybon, Raybon, Mr. Gates. Raybon down through the rosy cross. Raybon down through theosophy and the golden dawn. Raybon through the right. Of a vision. Raybon. Raybon, Raybon. Raybon, Raybon. Raybon, Raybon. Raybon, oh sunny days. Raybon, gold upon the spool. Raybon, Jandun, Raybon. Raybon, you holy fool. Raybon, sunny days. Atomic and nuclear age. Raybon, Raybon, Raybon. Raybon, thy printed page. Raybon.
Resurrect, if not our beloved, Marcus Aurelius said, I consist of spirit and body. Time affects the body, but the life of the spirit has no meaning, either in the past or in the future. All its life is concentrated in the present. Now, I loved Sunny, and I miss him very, very much. We came to Knopf at the same time, and for all those 3+ decades, we had a wonderful partnership and friendship, punctuated a few times a year by sometimes wonderful and sometimes inscrutable visits to his office, as well as cherished and long-remembered meals around this town. He was always kind and patient with me, tolerant of the various fictions and fraudulences of my trade. I dwell not in the world of books, per se, documentary film. Is that your influence, Gita, his patience with a filmmaker? I am not them. Clearly, as many attesters this afternoon certainly are, a writer. But I have been fortunate to work with and literally draft behind the supremely gifted writers Jeffrey C. Ward and David Duncan as we amplified our documentaries with companion books, stand-alone companion books, I want to stress, for Knopf, for Sunny. My day job is to edit Jeff and Dayton at many junctures along our complex but always exhilarating process. With that perhaps intolerable meddling comes a promise to the writer that everything cut might have a second life in the book. That is to say, what we would give to Sunny. That every sentence assassinated for so-called cinematic clarity might be reborn in the book. That facts cavalierly dismissed as too many notes would be heard in their fullest musical expression in the book. It became the safety valve for each project, saving relationships, the exit ramp that soothed the pain of the blood that really does collect on the editing room floor. That ramp always ended with Sunny in his office. He became the final outpost, the last century, as it were, before the unknown. Over the 32 years I knew Sunny, I became aware that people often misread him and thought him somehow intimidating. He did not suffer fools, to be sure, and there was a great silence that often enshrouded him, as many have mentioned this afternoon, lending mystery to him and prompting curiosity and attraction in us. But he was an enormous noticer and a great, great listener. I loved that silence. His silences, he owned them 100%. His watchfulness. I loved that when he did speak, he brought wisdom and clarity those of us who speak first and think second rarely possess. Each visit over those 32 years, whatever stage of the bookmaking process we were at, led to the inevitable, let me give you some books. And here would be Carl's latest, or Michael's, or James, or Ish's. I think you'd like Lark and Termite, he said one day as he casually handed me Jane Ann Phillips' novel. I did. Even after a discussion about Shakespeare, handed me Henry V. It was a great process that would go on year after year. I loved it. And I loved him even more for bringing me so much closer to such great literature and found in unexpected places. And he came to my screenings all the time, not finished, polished films, but rough cuts, unfinished films, and fine cuts, screenings that would last for days, for long series like The War and the Roosevelt's Jazz, the Vietnam War, Civil War, baseball. I once got into a pretty heated discussion with him in his office about the relative merits of baseball versus cricket, the latter a sport for which I express particular disdain. Sunny, as you can guess, felt the opposite. And for several minutes, maybe rounds, we traded punches, never quite landing a decisive blow. At one brief pause, paused as we were both catching our breath, Sonny stared at me from behind his desk, dressed all in black as usual, smoking a cigarette, whose cloud engulfed him, it seemed, this day in an ever more sinister aura. And then his eyes purposefully looked down and fixed on something on his always to me impressively clear desktop. My eyes instinctively followed his and came to rest on what he was looking at, a pistol. He looked back up at me, and I think without further audible conversation, we agreed that yes, cricket was a great interviewed Vartan Gregorian in this building a few years before I met Sonny. He was then the president of this library. After the filming was over, Vartan gave me a tour of literally the miles of stacks. And finally, after galloping down one claustrophobic corridor after another, he stopped suddenly and opened his arms. This, he said, surveying his library from his guts, this is the DNA. Sonny, our great listener, our great reader, knew that in his guts. We are obligated in his memory to pass this genetic message for Sonny, for us. This is from that Henry V, Act 5, Scene 2. A good leg will fall, a straight back will stoop, a black beard will turn white, a curled
terrified, and that I thought maybe I would be less scared if he could put me in an
somewhere near him. He took this in, nodded. When I arrived on my first day, I found that not only was I nowhere near Sunny, I wasn't even on the same floor. Not only was I not on the same floor, I wasn't even at the same imprint. I think he stopped just short of giving me a desk on the corner of 3rd Avenue. Almost everything I needed to know about working for Sunny I learned that day. He was not going to deprive me of the challenge of figuring things out on my own. He was going to give me room, always more room than I wanted, and editorially and otherwise, he was going to expect me to find my own way, with the understanding, of course, that I had better not fuck things up. In these painful last weeks, I have found myself reflecting on how lucky we are to be alive at this particular moment in time. How fortunate we are to be living in a sliver of history that happens to contain both Michael Ondaatje and Kazuo Ishiguro. What an enormous piece of luck to have been in publishing in the age of Sunny Maita. I know that secretly, every author I've had the privilege of publishing came to me mainly to get closer to him. Who could blame them? How to describe the extraordinary experience of being near, with, beside Sunny? It was like being fleetingly touched by grace. Many of us here today have been on the receiving end of his exquisite gestures. All of us observed his gentleness with the writers he so admired, his sensitivity to the work, how every detail commanded his scrutiny, the intensity of his focus, the unparalleled and life-changing quality of his attention. Every time, it was like stepping into a ray of sunlight. One weekend in the spring of 2012, he took me to the Ring Cycle. After 72 hours of nearly uninterrupted opera, of which I should mention I was not then a fan, I emerged blinking to find that I had fallen in love with Wagner. What I had really fallen in love with, of course, was the experience of listening to music with Sunny. Sunny was above all a listener, listening to colleagues, to authors, to music of every kind. Was one of Sonny's greatest gifts. He was uncannily alert to the music around us in whatever form it happened to come. For nearly 25 years, I was engaged in an ongoing conversation with him about books, a conversation that was among the greatest joys of my adult life. I am pretty sure that talking about books with Sunny is the most fun it's possible to have. He was thrillingly promiscuous in his taste. He loved everything if it was good, without care for style or genre. And he was the person most likely to approach a book with a truly open mind. But I think what I loved best about working with him was his sense of mischief, the gleam in his eye when he thought he might be able to stir up a bit of useful trouble. There was a feeling of almost criminal collusion. He was an outlaw in the service of books. He was also the most efficient editor on the planet. He could pose a single question that somehow cast an entire novel in a completely new light. Or he might simply ask you what you thought of a particular character. You'd reply, and he would tilt his head slightly, raise an eyebrow, and say, "Oh." One word, and you found yourself reconsidering everything you thought you knew, flooded with late-breaking revelation. This, in particular, gives me enormous hope for the future, because I know that so many of us in this room have internalized that voice. How to find a way forward without Sunny, you won't have to. Sunny is the voice you will hear in your head for the rest of your life. The man we all adored may no longer be glaring at us on a daily basis in the hallways of Alfred A. Knopf, but I assure you, the conversation will continue. Among the many, many things I will miss about Sunny are his eccentricities. He asked me once, with something like horror, if I ever drank coffee on the street. greatest delicacy and seriousness, he'd send me a shockingly colloquial email. So, are you cool with that? Or he'd be midway through an astute editorial observation and suddenly conclude with, and all that other sort of jazz and stuff. The best, of course, was the way he said goodbye, because he never, ever said it. Invariably, on the phone, in person, he said instead, I'll see you later. Every time, I felt the most immense delight and relief. Not goodbye. No such thing as goodbye. Sonny, I'll see you later.
Explicit, and he was chortling over it because some scene of intimacy, which, believe me, was not explicit. You get the gist. I mean, if I'm writing about pit bulls, well, where could it go from there? But where Sonny would actually say, I think that's a little strong. I think I've got to tone it down. And now he's publishing 50 Shades of Grey, unapologetically, with a huge, huge success. I remember Sonny changed the way I, being a kid from Florida and not having much, spent much time in New York, thought about New York. I mean, it became so I couldn't think of coming to New York without thinking of Sonny and going to dinner or going to have lunch with him or something. But I remember, it usually revolved around one thing. And I remember one of the VEAs or something that there was, Knopf was having a big party. It was on a rooftop party down in Chelsea or something. And I was supposed to show up. And the elevator broke, and I was supposed to find Sonny somehow. And I got up into this room full of celebrities, incredibly wonderful authors, and I can't find Sonny anywhere. Someone came up to me and said, grabbed me and said, he's not here. I said, why? She goes, he said he wanted to get the fuck out of here. And I said, where is he? She goes, I'll take it. And we went out to a little room. We left the party. We wound our way through this townhouse. There was a little balcony with like a couple of dead plants on it. And Sonny was out there smoking because they wouldn't let him smoke at the party. And he just was shaking his head. And so I knew where always to find him. You just went to the farthest place away from all the people. And he was just sitting there thinking. It was wonderful. And the other thing is, we talk about books and how we love books. And it was a rare thing, all of us in this room had this experience where we had manuscripts sent to us, all writers, people want a blurb. And they want that you get the manuscripts pre-advanced. They want you to say something nice about the manuscript. And if it's a friend of yours, it's really a burden, because sometimes the manuscripts are terrific and sometimes they suck. But you have to come up with an artful way to say no, or an artful way to write something that looks like a blurb. But in the cold light of day, they're not going to use it in any advertising because it's not quite blurb level. But we hardly ever got anything from Sonny. Very rarely. I get manuscripts from editors I've never met before. I rarely get any, but when I did get something from Sonny, it would always come with like a little note on it. One of his writers, or a writer that was a book that was coming out, he would say, you should take a look at this. I think you'll write it. And if you got a manuscript from Sonny, you blurred that sucker. Didn't matter what it was. It was the greatest book you had ever read. Recruited Oprah's bodyguards to stand in a circle around him in the middle of the Miami Beach Convention Center, and he lit up. I just think that's an incredible story. I have so many things to be thankful and grateful for, Sonny. Experiences I would never have had my background because of him. And one of them, interestingly, occurred today. I spent this morning in a, we were working on a book together, it would have been our 12th when he passed away. And the book takes place in Florida, as all of them do, and it involves snakes. We have an invasion of giant snakes in Florida right now, and I'm always rooting for that kind of thing. But I think it's the best thing that could happen to tourism. But anyway, we needed to do a little photo session. So being Manhattan, I somehow knew that there would be, you could find a big snake in Manhattan for a photo shoot. And if you called the right people, you could get anything. So I spent the morning in a photo studio with a 10-foot Burmese python named Bumble. I swear to God, it's like a showbiz python. He's been with all kinds of celebrities, supermodels, you know, skin defoliant ads, everything. And as I sat there with a snake crawling all over me, and I just thought, I mean, in my mind, I thought, he's not there, I can't send him a picture, because he would have appreciated it. He would never have showed up, but he would have appreciated it. The world we all inhabit, the world of books is never going to be the same without him. But Sonny, I got the picture for you. Thank you so much.
Who gave me his friend Sonny. And Sonny became my editor and my publisher. I had no idea that I'd won the jackpot. Of course, the words editor and publisher are useless in describing what Sonny was to me. As I told him much later, I said to Sonny, the gods dumped on me from a great height, and then they really panicked, and they gave me you. I knew nothing about writing books, let alone publishing. But Sonny transformed this potentially uncomfortable time for me only Sonny would work this magic. He decided that I couldn't endure the usual rounds of public appearances and press. He decided that this would be intolerable for me. Sonny, with his genius instinct and his panache, he created space around the book and allowed me to be safe in the shadows. And Sonny, of course, decided what the book should look like, another of his great gifts, as we know. One day he asked me to come to his office to show me a cover for my book. I sat across him at that famous desk. He saw me glancing at some discarded and perfectly nice-looking covers for my book in his waste paper bin. And he handed me another one, and he said, "You don't need to look at those. This is the one. And if you don't like it, I will kill you." And I didn't even know about the gun at the time, the pistol. Sonny is a loss because he's a giant, as we've been saying, in the world of books. But his expansiveness was met by its opposite, and that, for me, is even more precious. His tiny gestures, his few and perfect words, his casual insistence that I take his friendship for granted, the way he kissed a cheek. Evenings and dinners with Geetha and Sonny were always elevated, but they were also raucous and familiar. Sonny was a bounteous host, and Geetha ebullient. Sonny would ignite the conversations that would fly around, while remaining, of course, the most quiet and dignified of us. I can see him now, sipping wine. I can see his beautiful wrists. Sonny was the oboe reed that set the tone. When recently, Geetha, Michael, and I had taken to drinking vodka bull shots, Sonny watched fond disdain as we argued and harangued about the madness of South Asian politics, and then he ordered us another round. We talked of journeys we might take together, he then sat to Sri Lanka, and us to their beloved India. And so we did assume a future. Sonny wrote to me from Delhi once, saying how much he treasured the peace and stillness of being outside at dusk, just watching parrots. I cannot bear that I will never again see an email from him saying, "We're home, come by, love, S."
Sonny had again been out of town. And it started to dawn on me that
this curious delusion about my status, perhaps applied not just to me, but to authors in general, that this man, despite appearing to be the embodiment of worldly sophistication, had a blind spot and had confused authors with some more exalted category. During my next few days in Amanda's apartment, I was nagged by the possibility that at any moment, someone, the doorman of their apartment block, for instance, would point out to him his mistake. But no such revelation seemed ever to strike Sonny. Not then, nor during the decades that followed. And it became the norm thereafter that whenever I passed through New York, I would stay with Sonny and Gita, that they personally would fuss about my breakfasts, my schedule, my bedlam. Staying at the Metters was neither ceremonious nor formal. The expectation was just to come and go freely, to loaf about, eat, drink, read, just as one fancied. Sonny himself was shuffling around in sweater and jeans, carrying with him manuscripts, books, documents. There were two large, wonderfully furnished reception rooms, but he'd always gravitate to a narrow anteroom or else to the kitchen table. I assumed at first Sonny should be left undisturbed to work, but soon noticed a recurring Metter household pattern. Gita would make a sudden pronouncement, a statement plucked from thin air, something of irresistible intellectual challenge, at which Sonny would look up from his work, shaking his head in disbelief. And for the next several minutes, all hell would break loose, as they argued with fury and laughter over the finer aspects of the German class system, or the Coen Brothers' new movie. These scenes struck me as peculiarly reminiscent of ones I'd seen in classical romantic comedies. One evening, I was sitting in a darkened Japanese restaurant with the two of them, and became aware Sonny hadn't spoken for some time. Then he'd stopped eating and was gazing into space. Gita, noticing I'd noticed, broke off to say, "Sonny, would you care to rejoin us?" At which point he began to pour out what was on his mind. One of his authors was about to receive bad reviews that coming weekend. The author was already devastated by early responses to his book. People were turning down invitations to the coming launch party. Sonny's words now took on a quasi-military cadence, a five-point plan to defend the author's confidence. The names of people he'd phoned the next day to create an entirely new guest list. Fresh arguments to persuade the author none of this was so bad. Here it was again. The extraordinary care for the writer, the near obsessive concern for the person behind the book. He once made a kind of confession to me. Sometimes, he said, I'll be in an airport or a restaurant or a store and overhear people talking about a book I published. And I feel so proud, I get this urge to rush over and say, "Excuse me, I just wanted to say, I published it. I published that book you were just now discussing." And here, I believe, is a key to his peculiar esteem for writers, an insight into Sonny Metter that eventually helped dispel most of my imposter syndrome. He revered authors not out of naivety, nor from any exaggerated romantic notion. He did so because they, we, were an essential part of a larger vision he had, a project to which he was massively dedicated. He believed in the value of a broad, thriving reading culture, believed that good books were fundamental to a decent human society. That's why he felt pride, the pride he did, when he thought he'd done his work well. That's why he got upset about Julian Barnes's hotel, why he had to extract me from a perfectly good book. The way he regarded authors was not, in the end, an eccentric error, any more than was the reverence he showed for certain booksellers or publishing companies. He had a huge faith in the importance of what many of us gathered here now, in our different ways, strive to do each day. I'm grateful I was alive at the same time, as his brilliant, gentle, graceful, unfailingly gracious manner, and to have received his counsel,